Leadership means different things to different people. Leaders create an inspiring vision, make a plan, and deliver their plan by motivating their team members. Leaders lead from the front. They walk the talk. Today, as part of the leadership series from Global TV, we have an inspiring leader who is very creative and innovative in his ideas, and he has succeeded in implementing all of them in the enterprises wherever he has worked. Dr. C.V. Anandabose, IAS. Ex-Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh, described him as an inspired civil servant. PM Narendra Modi calls him man of ideas. He is from the batch of 1977 IAS. Dr. Bose currently is the one-man commission on labor reforms in the context of COVID-19. He is advisor to Government of India Heritage Project. He has been a collector. He has been secretary, chief secretary, principal secretary in many ministries in the center and the state. Dr. Bose was chairman of Habitat Alliance. He was a member of UN Habitat Alliance Council. He has been a university vice chancellor. He has been managing director of NAFED. He has been chairman of Coconut Development Board. I can keep on talking about Dr. Bose, but what inspires us is that he is a man of creative and innovative ideas, and he has succeeded in implementing all of them. Dr. Bose, hearty welcome to our discussion today.
Thank you.
And I'm sure your words of wisdom on leadership will definitely be beneficial to the listeners of this program. I heard that you stepped into leadership positions from Deepika Children's League. So we want to hear a little bit about, did you have the leadership skills from an early childhood, or you built it up over a period of time as you grew up in your career?
Thinking in retrospect, I think I perhaps had leadership qualities from the childhood. As you mentioned, its manifestation came when I was elected General Secretary of the Deepika Children's League, which is the largest children's league in India today. Even at that time, it was. Now, right from childhood, I think I had some leadership qualities manifest in many ways. Well, after the Deepika Children's League assignment, I was elected unanimously chairman of the college union. In those days, you know, these kind of elections were based on politics, but I was elected unopposed as an independent candidate. Even at school, right from the third standard, I used to be the school leader in every class. And when I became the SSLC, that was the 10th standard, there was no plus two in those days. There I was what you can call the general secretary of the school, maybe the head boy. But if I may state serious things in a lighter vein, I think my leadership qualities became evident when I was of 7 years old. There was a drama staged in our village, Manan.
Okay.
I was very sure that the drama will succeed only if I am made the hero. But my brothers and others decided that the drama will succeed only if I am kept away from the scene. So they started the drama without me. That was something which I was not willing to accept. So what is the way out? For every problem, there is a solution. There was in our village a gentleman, young man called Manichar.
Okay.
He has an uncanny knack. He will find solutions to any problem and find problems in any solution. So I met him. He said, what's your issue? I want to act in the drama. You will, he said. But then the rehearsals went on without me. The drama also was staged without me. The drama was based on Uttanapada, King Uttanapada, and his wives, Suriji and Suniti. Dhruva Kumara, you know, son, tries to sit on the lap of the dad, the king. The other mother did not like it. The boy is dragged out. The climax reaches. As this was going on the stage, off stage, I asked Manichetan, you promised that you will make me act in the drama, but what is happening? He said, don't worry, there is still time. He made me adorn the ACC uniforms, khaki. He also created a peak cap, gave me a cross belt. Lo and behold, I am the local sub-inspector. Once power is with me, I knew how to use it. I just marched onto the stage, caught hold of the king's hand and said, you are under arrest. The king didn't know who this is. Just pell-mell everywhere. Somebody whistled for the curtain. The curtain came diagonally, one part up, one part down. And those things which were fitted onto the males, make them females, they all fell apart. There was total pell-mell. When I went home for this arrest, I was arrested by my parents and my brothers. They decided nobody in the house should talk to me. I heard that boycott originated in Ireland when Captain Boycott was, you know, like avoided by the entire community.
Yes.
But I knew the concept of boycott really happened in a tiny little village called Mananam, where I was boycotted. Probably I would request you, Paul, and the Global TV, please change the word from boycott to bossycott, because that is what really happened in my younger days. So these are my childhood memories about my leadership style.
Is there any person or any incident which has made you change the way your leadership style?
Well, to be specific, there is one person and one incident. I think even now, in my mind, my leadership icon is my dad. He was a freedom fighter. Like all youngsters in those days, he was also a freedom fighter. And you know, in those days, all freedom fighters were marked by sacrifice, sense of sacrifice, dedication, commitment, and patriotism. See, there was a time when the first communist ministry which came to power through elections in Kerala, the EMS ministry in 1957, there was large-scale agitation against the government. There was a human cry that this communist government has to be dismissed. There is what is called the liberation struggle.
Yes.
Every day, there is picketing against the newly elected government. Mananam was a place where almost 99.9% were against the government. My father was particularly a Marxist, but he had a feeling that an elected government should not be dismissed. That was his conviction. He stood by the conviction, and against all odds, he could stand to his could show the grit, his courage of conviction. I think that is something which has always impressed me. If you feel that something is right, irrespective of the noise around you, you should be able to stick to your guns and be on the side of what you think is right. So he is one person who has really influenced my leadership qualities. The incident took place again in my college in Mananam. We had a principal, Father Papias, a very nice person. He loved the children and he had groomed me up. He was my headmaster as well.
Okay.
He had groomed me up in school and in college. But when I came to college and was elected as the college union chairman, I had a feeling that my teachers and the principal were treating me as the boy next door. I was growing within me. There was a rebel in me. I thought, I am the chairman, I am a mature person. Why are they treating me like a kid? This feeling took bizarre directions. Those were the days when strikes in college means pelting stones at the transport bus or even pelting stones at the police, inviting a lathi charge, getting photographed in the hospital, then the red carpet of political power is always with you. But I was not a leader of that type. We will go and report to the principal that we are going on strike. He will not say yes or no, but from his silence, we know, okay, go ahead. A few speeches, and then we disperse. Then there was a feeling all around, no, we should be more aggressive in our strikes. So there was pelting of stones at the transport buses, provoking police for lathi charge, everything was there. And I, who was a chairman, I was responsible for all this. Though, of course, I did not even throw any stone at anybody or any vehicle at any time. But the responsibility was on me. Once the examinations were to be boycotted, I think I always stood first in the class, even for this boycotted examination. But then I was suspended. I was suspended from the college because there were pressures on the principal. Why are you becoming so soft to this fellow? Suspend him. He had to suspend me. Then I found that I gave a very impassioned speech to the youngsters. I was only 17 years at that time. I said, my future is finished. That's okay. But your future should not be finished. I'll never allow anybody to finish your future. You know, this was a demagogic speech. Students were enraged. They marched to the monastery where the father principal was staying. In front of the church, he was caroled. He was caroled by his darling, that is me at that time. He groomed me up right from the school days. What a, like Julius Caesar, he would have said, "Etu Brute, you too, Brutus." That was the time. After that, you know, I went back to my house. My grandmother, she did not talk to me. My mother did not even look at me. My brothers and sisters avoided me. That night I decided. Still then I thought, for all that I do, somebody else is responsible. Either the parents or society or the teachers. That time, at the age of 17, that night, I knew I am responsible for all my actions. The next day I went to college. I asked all the students to come to the college assembly hall. Thousands of students were there. I went and requested Father Principal, all the students are there. You please kindly come. He didn't know what is going to happen. Is it something worse than Karao? But he came with me. There I said, yesterday what happened should not have happened. That was the moment when our guardian angel had left us. We love you. We respect you. We are your children. Such a thing will never happen in this college. I think the allurement of political red carpet was there before me. Those students, leaders of those days, you will know who they are. Two of them became chief ministers. Okay. And others became ministers. I had the red carpet, political red carpet before me. But I knew, no, that is not the value which I should imbibe. After that one day, without any provocation, this Father Papias, he called me to the church. He prayed there. Then he gave a pat on my cheek and said, endearingly, you have a bright future. You should not spoil it. Yes, it is Father Papias and the incident of garrowing him, which turned out to a turning point in my life. I love Father Papias. I'm sorry for the, I apologize to him for the grave wrong which I have done to him. He has been the guardian angel, which was sent by God to show me the right way. I think you are now speaking about the quintessence of leadership. What is the quintessence of leadership? I would say with Father Papias as a witness, leader is one who knows the way, one who shows the way, one who goes the way. I think if I could be anywhere near that concept of a leader, it is because of these two individuals. One is my dear father and my very dear Father Principal, Father Papias.
You know, Dr. Bose, when I was listening to you, so your way of putting it across, it really gave me that feel of what you are going through. And you are telling about the courage of conviction. I think that is what came out from you, which was probably inbuilt, maybe because of your father's influence, or it is instinctively within you. That's true for, I think, most of the leaders. The courage of conviction is very important, because when we take decisions, as you know, I'm sure all of us take decisions without knowing what is the outcome of most of the decisions, what happened. We won't have alternatives in front of us. So really, that courage of conviction and the fact that you had two people in your life who directed your energy towards what all of us are benefiting today through your work, what we see. Now, during your tenure as district collector in Kollam, I found that you had so many innovative things which are being practiced across the country, many of the district today. One was the Nirmiti Kendra, which is a low-cost housing scheme. I think that has gone global. Then the District Tourism Promotion Council. Then your file to field program, which I think you started when you were a sub-collector in probably Pala. Annapurna, which was the cooperative for women, which probably is the forerunner of today's Kudumbashree. The micro credit scheme for the fishermen. The first houseboat. And there are so many, I think about another three or four items I found you did or started as a district collector. I'm sure when you introduce such schemes in our society or even anywhere, there'll be a lot of resistance which comes across to your team members. How did you manage to overcome this resistance and get these schemes implemented? Because these are new, innovative, and I'm sure anybody would have, there will be a resistance to it from the team. How did you overcome this?
Thanks for reminding me of my humble efforts at innovation in government. One government document has listed 32 innovations, institutions and movements which are attributed to me, and some of which have been classified with the United Nations as the AB model of development. AB means Anand Bose. And they also gave the global best practice nomination 4 times for some of these initiatives. Now, coming to the specifics of your question, resistance to innovation. The resistance to change is always there. The resistance to change comes mainly because of the fear of the unknown. They do not know what you are speaking about. This is something new, which is something unheard of. There is always a fear of the unknown. Then there is a fear of obsolescence, fear of irrelevance. Fear of obsolescence means, you see, when these computers came in force, computers became popular, the typists had a feeling that their knowledge is going to be obsolete. So there is resistance to that. When printing was invented, the scribes protested because they knew their knowledge is becoming obsolete. This fear of obsolescence always comes in the mind of others. So they will naturally resist. The fear of irrelevance also is there, you know. Yes, when something is come which can replace me, I become irrelevant. Therefore, it is very natural that there is resistance against innovations. I have gone through this process many, many times. Because by the grace of God, I would say, I could always come upon some innovative solutions to problems. This is not because of any merit of mine, but it just happens, I would say. It just happens. And that is why so many of these innovations are there. When all these innovations were there, initially there was a lot of criticism. And even mudslinging was there. Motives are attributed to me. And I found that even those who I expect would support me, they are opposing me. So initially I was frustrated. But I told you about what I inherited from my dad. I always had a feeling within me, come what may, whatever I have done is right. I have no ulterior motive in this. Let anybody oppose it. I will go ahead alone. As Gandhiji said, ekla chalo, ekla chalo. That is always in my mind. But now I tell you the other version of that. I have probably become mature by age. I feel that whenever you come with a change, don't expect others to accept your change. As Matthew Arnold said, you should be like the teacher in an idiot school. You have to keep on repeating till your student learns what you want to teach him. You have to keep on repeating, teacher in an idiot school. And it is said, you know, if the student does not learn, the teacher has not taught, which is true. An innovator has to take on this responsibility of explaining the whole world and convincing them. That's a very uphill task. Till it is accepted by society, I think this frustration will be there. And there is something called frustration management. I think an innovator should always master the art of frustration management. We now hear about the art of living. I would also say, a frustrated management is the art of leaving. That is how to leave a place where you feel that reason has fled the brutish beast and men has lost their reason, as Shakespeare would put it. This is a kind of a dichotomy which an innovator has to face. It will take time for an innovation to get stabilized and get accepted by others. I think time is a solution for this.
And I think it's true, even in the case of computers, there was a lot of resistance. But today, nobody lives without a computer. I remember I used to work in a computer company initially for some time. And then when we used to go with computers in the banks, they used to put it in one locker room and lock it up. The manager wouldn't even open it. It took a lot of time for it to get implemented. It's a very, very valid lesson, Dr. Bose. And you have worked in various types of organizations. We all have a typical leadership style. Do you adapt your style to the organization, or you stick to the style which you have inherited or you have learned from the beginning?
You see, every leader evolves over a period of time. And this evolutionary process is best demonstrated in the most popular leaders, two leaders in the world, Jesus Christ and Lord Krishna. Jesus Christ was born in the manger. Lord Krishna was born in the prison. Whether you are born in the manger or born in the prison, if there is leadership quality in you, it will evolve. Jesus Christ had only half a normal person's life to complete his mission. And he has built up an institution which survives even now with aplomb, the Christianity. And who were his disciples? His disciples were illiterate fishermen mostly, isn't it? He wanted one educated person, the accountant of Jerusalem, Judas. You know what happened. So he built up an institution, a mission with illiterate people with him. And he had to undergo crucifixion. Even there, he gave the message, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because he was clear about his mission. And now come to Krishna. You see, did Krishna ever had a minute without challenge? He was born in prison. And the moment he was born, he was hurried across a turbulent river Then he was looked after by foster mother. And even there as a child, he had to encounter demon after demon coming to attack him. And when he finally overthrew Kansa and could establish a kingdom, he could not resist Jarasandha, the king. So he had to shift his capital. And then he had to see his own kins fighting with each other. He could not prevent it. And after the end of it all, all the great soldiers of Yadavas, they started fighting against each other. And finally, Lord Krishna became a victim of the arrow of an unknown hunter. Now, these are the travails through which the leaders went by. We forget all these things, but they evolved as great leaders. And now, the greatest leader on earth, if I may say so, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, the barrister who felt that to be a worthy English man, he should wear three-piece suits, and he started learning Western music and dance. In Peter's Marysburg, he discovered the leader within himself. When he was thrown out of the train, first-class train, he had three options before him. One, either keep quiet and swallow the dirt. Number two, go to the court. He's a barrister. Go to the court and win his case. Number three, take it as a common cause and fight for the rights of his people who are thus affected. He chose the third course. Therefore, the barrister became a popular leader. Do you know, his fee at that time was 5,000 pounds for a barrister. That is a whopping amount even in those days. He decided to sacrifice all these things. He came back to India. He found stalwarts as leaders here doing nothing. You know, he discovered India. He threw off his three-piece suit and he started wearing the loincloth. The entire India awakened. The entire India found its inner strength. Here is one man who could lead through ahimsa. I think every leader evolves. Every leader evolves. Even in a tiny leader like me, this process of evolution is there. And as Darwin would say, there is always survival of the fittest in the field of leadership as well. Thank you.
You have evolved as a leader over a period of time, and you adapted to your leadership skills to suit the times, is what your message to the listeners is, right?
Yes.
Dr. Bose, I find that you are an author of more than 40 books, which means you must be taking quite a bit of time around that. You also have a regular job. Even now, you work, you participate in discussions like this. You attend functions on a regular basis. We also, leaders, find it very difficult to manage even with one job itself. So how do you manage your time?
Without going into the Harvard Business School or Peter Drucker and others, I got my simple lesson in time management from a renowned editor and author in Kerala, N.V. Krishnavarya.
Okay.
He was at that time editor of the Kumkumam Group of Publications in Kollam, where I happened to be collector. We used to go for many public functions together. While we were returning, we were traveling in my own car. He told me, "Collector, you speak very well. Why don't you write?" I gave a rather foolish reply to him, "Sir, I am harder for time." As if I had the time, I would have become a Shakespeare or a Kalidasa. I didn't think of it at that time. But he gave a pat on the back and said, "To be a writer, you need only the mind, not time. Mind is what is important, not the time." I think time management, the principle, basic principles of time management, I think relies in this. Once you have the mind to accomplish a task, time will certainly obey you. We are told that time and tide waits for no man, but time and tide, certainly time, waits for the man who means business. You see, there is something called flexi time, isn't it? Now, when we say Indian standard time, we know what it means. But flexi time means, you know, this 24 hours, is it the 24 standard hours, 24 Indian hours, or 24 your own hours? A 24 hour can be stretched into 240 hours if you want so. It is said, the mind is its own place and in itself can make a heaven of hell or a hell of heaven. Once your mind is set on accomplishing a task, time will certainly be there. time will be your support. And every day, you have to break your assignment in various parts. See, once you look at the whole lot, you become overawed by it. You break it into various parts, then you find you can easily tackle one by one. Try to achieve yesterday what you can do today. Time is flexible. Your mind is what is more important. You should have your own timetable. You should break your activities into various manageable parts. Then you will find it is easy to manage time. I think time management is very important for any successful manager. I think even in government, of course, you can put off your files. But in the private sector, I also worked as advisor in the corporate sector. There, everybody is obsessed, closure. That means find the results, produce the results.
Yes.
Whereas in government, procedure is more important than results. But in a corporate sector, it is not like that. So the concept of time also changes between government and the corporate sector. But for any successful manager, I think the time is at his disposal, provided he has the fixity of purpose, single-mindedness of purpose. Once that is there, once you are result-oriented, I don't think you will be finding time a stumbling block at all.
So the lesson for us is, if you have a purpose in front of us, we will find time to do it.
Accomplish it.
You know, one of the lessons which I have come across, that there are people, you give them additional jobs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they'll find time to do it. They are capable of doing multiple things. But if some person who is only doing one task, you give him additional one task, they will say, no, I don't have time. It's very difficult for me to do. A person who is doing 100 tasks, he is given a one task additional. It's just 1% additional effort for him. A person who is only doing one task, for him, an additional task is 100% extra effort. So there is, I always find in my working environment, this is to be a fact.
If I may intervene and supporting you.
Yeah.
The best case in time management is in the Egypt-Israel war. It took only 6 days for Israel to win a war and establish a nation, because they were bound to establish a nation. I think time is not the factor. Mind is the factor. Yes, mind is always the factor which decides success or failure. And if I may add one more thing, you know, in the Indian legend, there is a goddess called Tatha Astu. Tatha Astu means let it be so. Like after the Christian prayer, we say, Amen, which means let it be so. This Tatha Astu, the goddess resides within your forehead. Once you start a task, if you say, my God, I don't have the time for that. I don't have the resources for that. I don't have the competence for that. I don't have the staff for that. This goddess will say from within, Tatha Astu, let it be so. But if you say, I will achieve this task. I will never take no for an answer. I am going to produce results. The same goddess will say from within you, Tatha Astu, let it be so. In psychology, this is called auto-suggestion. You are your own master. You are the master of your own time and achievement. Yes, always your goddess will say from within you, Tatha Astu, let it be so. It depends on what you decide in your mind.
Dr. Bose, I am sure you have been a leader from your early days. You said from 7 years old, you have recognized your leadership skills. Do you really enjoy being a leader?
The question should be whether others enjoy my being their leader. I do enjoy my leadership role. And you know, as a member of the Indian Civil Service, it's always a leadership role which you are supposed to play right from the first day in office. I do enjoy being a leader. I do enjoy being with people. I think a leader does not exist in a vacuum. A leader is a leader only when he is within a team. And his team is very important. It is a team which makes a leader. It's not the other way around. That is, you find competent persons around you. Even if you are dead as a leader, you will come up as a leader. But if you pack your team with incompetent persons just because they will say yes to you, then you will fail as a leader. A leader is known by the quality of the team which he keeps. That's very important. if I may say, add one thing. What distinguishes a leader from the camp followers? It is whether he is able to listen to the sound of silence. A leader has to see what others do not see. A leader has to hear what others do not hear. In short, a leader should be able to hear the sound of silence. Only that leader can survive. Only that leader will be respected. Only that leader will add value to the pack.
Dr. Bose, if we have to give two advices to the youngsters who are aspiring to be leaders, what would that be from your side?
I will say, never take no for an answer. Never. If you are bent on something, if there is a problem, there is always a solution. Look for the right solution or create the solution. This I am saying because look at the Wright brothers, Orville Wright and Wilbur Wright. When they started on the idea of a flying machine, everybody told them, leave flying to the birds. But the Wright brothers said, if birds can fly, so can we. So we have the aeroplane. And when Ford was after the idea of a motor car, even Edison told him, this is an unworkable idea. Join me. Let us work together and discover many new things. But he also stuck to his gun. Therefore, we have the motor car. Napoleon said, impossible is a word found only in the dictionary of fools. Therefore, my advice, if I may advise, because Lord Macefield said, advice is seldom welcome. And those who need it the most like it the least. Therefore, I refrain from advising, but you ask for it. And second advice, especially for the leaders in government service, never, ever, for a moment, think that your power and authority is yours. No, your power and authority is for the position. Your power and authority is for the chair. The moment you leave the chair, your power and authority will vanish into thin air. So never, never gloat over this. Build up the man within you. If anybody tells, after your death, he was a good man, that is the greatest reward for you as a leader. In fact, when you retire from government service, there is a question, oh, he has retired. Meaning, sorry, he has retired. Others will be, he has retired. Thank God he has retired. You choose this, whether you want to belong to category A or category B, especially who are in government. Be on your own. Try to be a good human being. A good leader should be a good human being.
Your message is very clear. Never take no for an answer if you want to become a good leader. And never think that your leadership is there forever unless you deliver. I mean, that's what I would interpret it this way, because you have been a civil servant. I'm sure you have passed the retirement age at some point of time, but then you have always been engaged and continues to be engaged because you have been effective and efficient in whatever you are doing. Probably you never took no for an answer. Your courage of conviction has taken you forward as a leader in any enterprise or any responsibility which has been assigned to you. I also know that you have won a lot of awards in the process, including Jawaharlal Nehru Fellowship. And as you yourself said, you were nominated 4 times for the Best Practices Award, probably a record in the history of Indian Administrative Service. And we all respect you as very, very accomplished IAS officer. And we are very fortunate today to listen to your words of wisdom on leadership. May you continue to prosper and continue to serve the society, because I think you are one of those leaders who really believe that service is what I am meant to do. End of the day, leaders make choices. I hope those who listen to this will make the right choice, understand the right message, and learn from what is told today in this conversation or discussion with Dr. Bose. Thank you so much on behalf of Global TV and on my behalf for being with us today. Thank you.